Hello, everybody. Welcome to another exclusive behind-the-scenes look at the Adler Planetarium's historic artifacts collections. As you know by now, I am Chris Helms. I am the collections manager here at the Adler Planetarium. Today, I want to show you all a couple of globes in our collection. Now, there's about 100 different globes in the Adler's historic artifact collection, so it makes up a sizable chunk of the objects that we do have. But I want to showcase two very specific ones here today. Both are from totally different regions of the Earth, from the world, and both are made entirely differently, using different materials, different construction techniques. The first is probably one of the rarest pieces that we have in the entire collection. That's the globe you see right behind me here. It's from the Western world. The second is going to be from the Middle East. Again, entirely different construction techniques, materials, even though they really show both the same stars and constellations looking up at the same sky. So let's go ahead and take these out of the case and we'll take a closer look. Collections Department's conservation lab. We've taken both globes out of their cases, but let's kind of break them down one at a time. The first one I want to talk about is this one here. This is a globe made by a man named Gerhard Mercator in 1551. Now, if the name Mercator sounds familiar, that's because most modern day maps use a system that he invented called the Mercator projection. It is a system for projecting a round sphere onto a flat map. If you don't use special calculations and special measurements and a special projection of the map, that can be very difficult. And so most modern maps that you use, if you open one up, chances are use the Mercator projection, which he invented. So in addition to being a cartographer and mathematician, a map maker, he also made a number of celestial globes and terrestrial globe pairs. He would sell them as pairs. There are only about 22 of those pairs left known to exist in the entire world, and the Adler has one celestial globe from one of those pairs. Now, earlier I had told you that this was one of the rarest globes that we had in our collection, and to be honest, it's actually one of the most rare and unique pieces that we have in the entire collection, not just our globes collection, because there are so few that still exist. Now, early globes, in European globes specifically, were made typically by making a solid wood or brass sphere and then engraving on the outside of that sphere, whether it's a map or the stars or whatever. What Gerhard Mercator did was, instead of making a solid sphere, he made a hollow, typically paper mache or pasteboard, essentially fancy cardboard sphere, and on that he would paste printed pieces of paper, what are called gores. They're essentially strips of paper here that taper off, they get thin at the top, and then they widen as they get near the equator. That's to allow a projection sphere to be kind of pasted onto a round wooden sphere. What this did was it made the globes easy to mass produce. He could print the paper relatively easily. He could make the paper mache wooden globes relatively easily. And this becomes a staple of Western globe making. Now, Louvain, Belgium, where he lived and did most of his work, really becomes a center of Western scientific instrument making and map making and cartography. And that's in large part thanks to Mercator and the way he constructed these globes. You'll see that this differs very significantly from the Middle Eastern globe from around the same time, both in materials and construction style as well. So let's go in here and take a little closer look at some of the constellations that Mercator has on here. Now, Mercator's celestial globes included the 48 typical Ptolemaic ancient constellations, the typical ones you know of, Cetus, Pegasus, that kind of thing. But he also created two brand new constellations, Coma Berenices and Antinous. You can actually see Coma Berenices right here, both of which continued to be used for a few hundred years. Now, on most Western celestial globes, the constellations are depicted from the outside perspective, which means all of the constellations that are people are typically looking inwards. So people here like Hercules or Andromeda or Perseus, you often see just their back, which is why we have a lot of different butts on our Western celestial globes. Now, Gerhard Mercator also, in addition to depicting all the constellations, also has quite a few stars depicted on here, and he used different sizes and colors for stars of various intensities and brightness. He also labels everything on here in all Latin, Arabic, and Greek, which is pretty unique for the time. The last thing I want to mention about this globe in particular is that in 1551, when Mercator made this, Europeans had very little idea of what existed in the southern hemisphere up in the sky in terms of constellations. And during colonialism, they were not inclined to ask the people who typically live in the Southern Hemisphere what their constellations were. So they either left it blank, which Mercator did typically, or made up constellations for down there. Now, in this case, Mercator left most of the Southern Hemisphere blank, but included this inscription here dedicating his globe, this particular globe, to George of Austria, the Prince Bishop of Liege, who was an important benefactor at the time. So here is our second globe of the day to look at. You'll notice this one is very different than the previous Western-style globe that we looked at. We actually don't know who made this globe. Unfortunately, they didn't sign it. We do know that it was made sometime between 1600 and 1700 in Lahore, Pakistan, what is now Lahore, Pakistan. Just like Louvain, Belgium, Lahore was a center of Middle Eastern instrument making and metallurgy, actually, as well. Typically, a Middle Eastern globe, a celestial globe such as this one, could have been made a couple of ways. The first way is to take two hemispheres and fuse them together into a single ball and then buff it out and polish it. Another way, now usually with that method, that first method, you would see a seam between the two hemispheres. This globe has no visible seam on it. So we're left to assume, as far as we can tell, that it was used making a method called the lost wax method. Now that involves creating a cast that is lined with a wax, a meltable wax on the inside. That wax is eventually melted away, and you are left with a perfectly usable cast that you can then fill with molten metal, such as brass or bronze, or gold or silver if you are extremely rich. Now, we believe that that's how this globe was constructed, and that was a pretty typical construction method for globes in the region. You notice it's a lot more time-intensive and probably a lot more expensive than the Western-style Mercator mass-produced globe, but it does make for some much more beautiful and striking pieces. Let's take a look at some of the constellations on here. Now, a couple things to notice about these celestial globes from the Middle East. First of all, you'll notice that they typically use the exact same constellations as their Western counterparts. Here you'll see the Gemini twins, Cancer, and Leo the lion, just for starters. Now, that's because even when this globe was being made in the 1600s and 1700s, between 1600 and 1700, they were still using the old Ptolemaic constellations from ancient times. That's pretty typical of Middle Eastern globes as well. The second thing I want you to notice is what looks like smudges all across the surface is actually individual star holes. There are 1,018 individual silver inlaid stars depicted on this globe. Again, a much more time-consuming and expensive process, but it makes for a beautiful, striking piece in the finished product. It must have been incredibly time-consuming to poke out each and every individual star hole on here. The third thing I want to talk about, which is a little harder to see on this globe, is the Southern Hemisphere. Now, the Middle Eastern globes also, Middle Eastern astronomers and cartographers also had very little access to the Southern Hemispheres down here at the bottom of the globe. And so, just like their Western counterparts, was typically they left it blank. They put no constellations down there, or they used that space to commemorate the globe or dedicate it to somebody else. And that's it. Thank you so much for watching another episode of Behind the Scenes with our historic collection here. I hope you really have a sense of how special and different and unique, but also very similar these two globes from very different regions of the Earth are, very different cultures. If you'd like to know more about these globes in particular or some of our globes in the collection as a whole, check out the video description and you will see their object numbers, which you can look up on our collection search page. Thanks for joining me, and I will see you next time.